Okay, so I'm going to open the meeting of the Frontier Regional School Committee for Wednesday, March 22nd, 2017. It's exactly 6:02. And we're going to start right off with the public hearing. I'll be turning it over to the Budget Committee, but I just would like to remind everyone that this is a friendly, comfortable discussion, but please still raise your hand and be recognized either by the chair or by the person who you are talking to. I just don't want any back and forth or something that gets to be just two people going on and on. It's a group discussion and it's a group effort. So I will turn it over to Patty now, Pat, and you can do your thing, please.
Sure. In the absence of our chair of the Finance Subcommittee, Mr. Smith, I will walk you through the budget. So you all have a copy dated today. Version 3, Public Hearing, School Committee Meeting of March 22nd, 2017. And I'm going to start looking at... nice and friendly.
Just raise your hand.
Page 4 of 36. This is a new sheet to our budget, and we're calling it the Student and Staff Data Sheet. This is something that Dr. Carey brought with her from her prior district, and I love it because it gives us a lot of information. So on the left-hand side, we're looking at our enrollment, and that, those numbers on top for 17 are locked in at the October 1st census because that is what our foundation enrollment is based on for the FY18 year. But our projected enrollment down below is adjusted to the number of students we have right now as of March 1st. And as you can see, we're predicting a big jump. But that's because we have a large bubble in our sixth grades. Our sixth and fifth grades, the next two classes are a large number. So if we are not expecting to get all 145, but if we hit the 120, we're going to need an extra teacher in the middle school because of class size. We haven't put that in the budget because we don't know if it'll happen, but it'll be something that we may be adding over the summer when we get closer to the number of students we know are coming. On the right hand side is the number of staff that work here at Frontier Regional, and in this current year we have 109.47. And next year we're projecting 107.37, or a reduction of 2.1 FTEs. On the bottom, teacher credentials, this is how our contract works and how everybody falls as far as education level. And we've just shown you how many teachers we have at each education level. So if we look at page 5, right now we're focusing on the budget section, and then we'll get to the assessment section. So right now, we're looking at a budget increase of 3%, and that has been mostly driven by personnel, contract costs, and health insurance. The steps were $69,839. The negotiated 2.5% increase, $166,604. We have new people advancing or getting on the longevity, and that added $4,500. There was a new stipend negotiated for teachers who teach advanced placement classes, and that's $15,960. We have an allowance for non-union salaries of $5,633. Those salary recommendations will be brought to the school committee in May for you to vote in June. We needed to increase our retirement buyback by $37,978. We reduced one instructional assistant, which saved us $20,899. We're also reducing 0.6 FTE of a psychologist, which will save us $44,925, and a 0.5 secretary, $13,819. Now, this next large number of 101,221, these are positions that exist in our current budget that we're going to be moving the funding. We're going to take it off the general fund appropriation and move it onto an alternate source, and I'll talk about that when we look at our school choice. So some of our other operational increases, trash removal needs to be increased. The school committee dues for the collaborative, $2,900. This is not new. We've been members of the collaborative. We've just never budgeted for the fees. Legal, $2,550. We're going to be entering a new 3-year contract with our attorney. And I believe Dr. Carey will be bringing that contract to the joint meeting in April for you to consider. We're looking for $8,000 for our building safety inspections. All of our, not just here at Frontier, but in our elementaries, our budgets for building maintenance never grew with the age of the buildings. So we're underfunded. So what we were trying to do is break out at least the annual inspections, the things we know, the alarm monitoring, the pest control management. Anything we know is a recurring cost, we're trying to get it in its own line item, so then the money in the building maintenance can truly go to building maintenance. Instructional software, $11,768. We became aware that all of our softwares were present and accounted for except our virtual high school, so we needed to add that cost. The school committee, at your last meeting, you voted $15,700 for a school resource officer. Our Franklin County retirement assessments up $33,639. Our summer services, $35,784. This is a combination of we lost a state grant for some of our summer services, and also we have more children in the building now who require summer services so that they don't experience regression. Our insurances, $145,601. All of our four towns are members of the Hampshire County Group Insurance Trust, so all of our towns are experiencing the health increase of 10.4% and 8% in our dental. At Frontier, we pay 80%, so we bear 80% of that increase. Some of the things we did decrease, the superintendent office expenses went down to Frontier by $2,238. I know when I spoke at the towns, your elementary schools took an increase in expenses, but that was because the two positions that were we lost the grant funding only affects the elementary level. It didn't affect the high school level. So if you're wondering why you don't see as big an increase as you did with the elementaries, this is why. And then we're also being able to decrease our tuitions, $100,487. We've had some heavy hitters in our out-of-district tuitions, and some of them have aged out. We've also been able to stem the flow of out-of-district tuitions by creating programs here at the high school to keep our children in district. And Karen Ferrandino, our SPED director, has also been working with our students with career transition services. So once they complete what would be their 12th grade education, we're helping them with career transitions because we still have them till they're 22. So we've been saving some money there. So that would add $311,859 to our budget, or 3%. Then the next pages are all detail pages. I want to skip over to page 18 of 36. And this is our school choice and charter. So at this time last year, the state was projecting that for the first time, Frontier would owe more money in choice and charter out than we would bring in choice receiving, in the amount of $69,788. So that was actually budgeted and assessed to the towns in a light item in our budget. At this point, they're telling us that this actual money we'll receive in 17 has gone up from 878 to 1,160, and the state charter aid was also increased in the budget process. So we're going to end up with $348,831 this year, which we had not had any intention of spending because we didn't know we were getting it. So we're banking all that money for 18. And then for 18, it looks like we'll be right side up $199,151. So we're going to take those two amounts, 348 and 199, which means we'll have available to spend $547,982. So that is where, on that page, we're going to move $101,221 over to this fund. And then also on the next page, on Circuit Breaker, we have a shortfall. So we're going to take the Circuit Breaker salaries and move them to this line item as well. So we'll be using $215,135. Leaving us a projected balance of $332,847. So page 19 is our circuit breaker. Because we have had so many out-of-district tuitions, our circuit breaker revenue has been really healthy. And you don't really want it to be. So we've been using those funds to develop programs. Currently, we have no children in the pre-K to 6 and out-of-district tuition and out-of-district placements. And that happened because we've grown specialized program at the elementary levels. Well, those kids are now coming up to Frontier. And if we want to keep them in district, we had to build the programs. So we've been using the circuit breaker money to fund those programs. Now, as our tuitions decrease, the circuit breaker revenues decrease, but we still need these positions. So we need to start weaning off the circuit breaker and moving over. And we're going to do it in our first year by moving it over to the school choice money, if that makes sense. Page 20 of 36 is our excess and deficiency fund. We were finally certified on February 2nd at $342,100. The school committee had allocated $28,000 for the central office move. And in discussions in the subcommittee and voted by the full committee, half of the remainder was used to offset the assessments. $157,050 was used to lower the assessments, and also that is what our available balance now is in excess and deficiency. Going back to school choice for 1 second, if we need that middle school teacher, we will use the funds in school choice to add that teacher if it comes to fruition. The next pages is our choice receiving and sending reports. But I think the one page that's most interesting is page 26, where we schedule how many children our choice and charter out by town and what the cost is by town. And just be aware, this is only your students from grades 7 through 12. We have a separate analysis for each elementary school. So this year, in total choice and charter, we will be paying out $1,009,615 of our budget to other schools to educate our students, educate 82 students who choose to go to other educational institutions. Starting on page 27, this is our assessment data. And on page 29 is the five-year enrollment, which is what we use to determine our assessments. And as you can see, the year we drop out is 2011 at 539 students, and the year we bring in is 2016 with 467 students, so we're down 72 students. Conway is adding 10, and everyone else is dropping. So unfortunately, that means that Conway's assessment is going to be going up more than the other towns. On the next page, we're looking at our revenues. And our minimum contributions required by the towns, the revenue decreased $230,995. Our Chapter 70 funding only increased $11,020. That was $20 per student. Adding the excess and deficiency, we're increasing it from this year by $57,050. Our regional transportation, we're projecting a decrease in revenue of $61,308 and an increase in the revolving transportation fund of $8,018. And page 31 is just the page from the state showing the each town's change in enrollment and why the required minimum contributions changed. Page 32 of 36 is the actual assessments. So the total assessments are going to go up 3.79% or $276,640 from our current year. It's a 9.93% increase to Conway, a 3.32% increase for Deerfield, a 1.47% increase for Sunderland, and a 2.13% increase for Waitley. Page 33 is just working the calculation. So we take our budget, the $10,438,983. We apply the Chapter 70 aid. We apply the free cash used. and then we apply your minimum contributions, and then the rest, the 2844931, is done through the 5-year average. So this is just the calculation that I brought forward to page 32. Page 34, this is how the regional transportation assessment works. We're projecting that we're gonna get $61,000 less, but I don't think it's going to be that bad, but because the percentage of reimbursement goes through the legislative process, we like to be conservative when we budget this. Other regionals have gotten into trouble. If the legislature says we're gonna get 100%, they've budgeted 100%. And when they only fund you at 60%, those schools have had to do mid-year layoffs to afford their transportation. So what I look at is our actual transportation that we reported on the FY16 end-of-year report, and 50% of that is the 107,677. So that's what I'm estimating our reimbursement to be. We subtract that from the budgeted transportation, and that leaves us $170,285. Now previously, before the regional transportation revolving account was established, any excess money coming in the regional transportation would then flow through to the excess and deficiency. So that the towns get their transportation money back, the state allowed us to have a regional transportation revolving account, and the school committee adopted it. So anything that comes over that 107 will go into that account and then will be assessed as a credit. And you can see that the FY16 excess regional reimbursement was $54,641, and that credit has been applied to the towns at their FY16 assessment rate. So the transportation assessment to the towns is $115,644. Page 35 is just my reconciliation that everything is spending we have funding sources for. And page 36 is the summary of the different allocation bases that we use with the town percentages. So, Madam Chair, that is our presentation.
Nice job.
Questions? Comments? Seriously? Okay, moving on. No. Well, let's digest for a second. Anyone on the committee? Any questions or any comments?
I'd just like to say, Patty, thank you so much for taking it step by step. That means a lot. I was able to digest it as we were walking through. And you answered a couple of questions, actually, by doing so.
Good, got it. That's helpful.
This budget doesn't provide is, if for some reason, we had to come up with money to move that oil tank away, but we're going to have to look for, we're going to have to find the funds.
Unless we auction.
That's right. But I'm
auction
saying
we sell it as is.
That we might need to find the money. So that's one thing we need.
Damien?
Excuse my ignorance because it's the first time I'm through this. What is circuit breaker money?
Okay, so circuit breaker was a fund that was set up by the state, and that also goes through the legislative process as to the percentage we'll get reimbursed. But because special education costs were getting increasing so much, if one student costs more than 4 times the state average, you get a percentage back on the overage. Okay. So that was the circuit breaker money.
Okay.
So when you keep your students in district, you're probably not going to be hitting that ceiling to break the circuit, to trip the circuit.
Right.
So it's to our advantage to keep our children in district. One of our schools here in the area that specializes in autism, next year their tuition for one student, day student, not residential, is $110,000.
Mr. Armstrong, just please introduce yourself and tell us
Bob
what
Armstrong.
Conway.
I mean, Conway.
Tell us what Conway you come from.
And you sound real confident about the state reimbursement for charter schools.
No, I'm not. I didn't say that.
Oh, well, your voice sounded confident. So I was just wondering where that confidence came from.
No. Nope. I have no confidence in that. If you look, what they budgeted, what they projected in 17 was very minimal. Through the legislative process, the joint committee put the money back into the budget so that we actually got more. But if you look at 18, according to Governor Baker, we're getting nothing again. So when I say that for this year, why I'm confident this year that we're going to get what they're projecting now is because we're basically through the time period where 9C cuts could affect it. So I'm more confident now about the FY17 reimbursement because it's, according to the people I talked to at the state, the revenues are coming in, so it doesn't look like we're going to have to do a second round of 9Cs.
They reported an increase yesterday in paper.
So my sources are correct.
Sir, again, introduce yourself.
Yeah, hi, I'm Paul Antea for the Waverly Finance Committee. And I've just got a couple of questions. Mm-hmm. Patty, do we have a number for what it costs for one student to be educated at Frontier Regional High School?
I do have that. Let me pull that up. I didn't bring that folder.
Okay, it's the last page.
So Frontier, an in-district student, is $17,045. The state average is $14,995. And I find that this is misleading at the high school level because I really think when they do this, they should break out high school from non-high school because high schools always tend to be more expensive than your elementary school because you have one teacher teaching five subjects and at the high school you have multiple teachers teaching five subjects. So it's just inherent that the high school is going to be more expensive in staffing. So I really wish they would break this out so we were looking at apples to apples because it looks like we're spending so much over the state average. But we're probably right in line with most high schools.
As a follow-up, on page 5, just educate me on this. Summer services, you spoke to that. You have a line item at 35,784. Is that mandatory or is that an optional?
It's a little bit of both. So the state grant that we lost is what we would use to prep. And Ms. Mitchell, correct me if I'm wrong, we're preparing our lowest sixth graders to get ready to come to seventh grade. And then the other piece is required by IEPs because there are very special needs children that need to go all year long. So we need to run those programs. And if we didn't run the programs, we'd have to send them somewhere because their disabilities are so severe, they could regress instead of keep progressing.
Are we drawing those students into this environment from other municipalities?
Yes, we are. So we try to, of course, we take care of our own first. But if we do have slots and the profile meets our programs, we will absolutely take in a child from other districts. And I believe we have three right currently.
So the breakdown is, do we have that?
What do you mean the breakdown?
The breakdown as to out of Frontier Regional High School district, students coming in that require those special services versus students here that require.
No, I don't have that broken out because we've got several different programs. We can get that information. I can get that from our SPED director, but I didn't break it out.
And you also said that there's a tuition decrease because of heavy hitters. What are heavy hitters?
We had one student that was costing us close to $300,000 a year. It was in what I call on a move-in. So they happened to move in, and it was actually Whately. And we got stuck with that bill from DCF, and we paid that. That child aged out in October. They turned 22. At one point, Paul, they lived right on the edge of Whately in Hatfield. Marty Barrett and I discussed it would be cheaper for us to buy the house and evict them.
It was a difficult
than
time.
Continue paying the tuition, but.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments?
Oh, okay.
You have another one? Okay, Paul.
On page 17, the tuition to non-public schools, what is that?
Those would be our out-of-district placements. So those are kids we have, and I didn't bring it, we have two children at the May Center. We have children at, I can't even think.
Collaborative.
Well, the Collaborative has its own line. I can't remember the other schools. We might have a child at Valley West. We have a child at the Perkins School. So those are our out-of-district tuitions. I think they're called 766 schools.
It'd be interesting to see a cost per special needs student, including them, as compared to the $17K for your average student in there. It'd be nice to get in the paper.
So could I just take note that because the choice money was higher than expected, it sort of covers up the still huge amounts that we're paying in charter outflows. And one of the things that you all could really help with is just sort of announcing to the town, you know, so many parents that decide on the charter option for the one of the reasons they do so is because they're unaware of the social cost to the town that's involved, and they don't know that it takes four students to come into the school to choice in to make up for that revenue of one leaving to the charter. And if we can do more to just start that conversation just to our neighbors and friends that when they're making this choice, it hurts your town. And in fact, if you want to hurt your town, it's about the worst thing you can do to your town as a parent financially.
Or not pay your taxes.
Or not pay your taxes. Yeah, that would be the worst. You're right.
Okay, let's stay on track.
But the point is that the culture has to shift and people have to be made aware, or just the information needs to be put out there that this choice has consequences for everybody else, for all of your neighbors.
I completely agree.
Chair, thank you.
I completely agree with that. But it goes far beyond simply understanding the impact that it has to the municipal government. And people don't understand. When I say people, I say your average person on the street in these four towns. They don't understand what's available here, what's available in their backyard for an education. And the reason they don't is because the communication channels are horrendous. Believe me, they don't get it. They don't get when they pull their kid out what they're losing here, what they're not making available to themselves, their family, the children. They don't get it. All they think is they're getting something better. How are they making that decision? I have no idea.
Marketing.
But we're not helping stem that tide by staying quiet.
I also like to point out, I'm continually stunned at the funding formula that is just so unfair, inequitable. We have 40 students leaving to choice, 42 leaving to charter, and for whatever reason they decide they have to go. The 40 leaving for choice cost the district $231,000, but the roughly 40 leaving to charter costs us $777,000, three times. So you have two students, one chooses to go here, but one chooses to go here. And because of the funding formula, we're evaluating this student four times as much as this student going out, regardless of why the parents choose. We have 40 going out for $250,000, we have 40 going out for $750,000. That's fundamentally, I'm stunned at how inequitable it is.
David?
to follow up on that, you could also argue the students coming in, our revenue coming in from the school choice is far less than what we're paying out.
That we don't get charter.
Right. I mean, if they could be the same.
Exactly.
A charter student and a school choice student, the same revenue, it would offset each other.
They haven't changed the formula around the choice since it started either.
1993.
Right. $5,000.
Charter's gone up. Choices stayed the
same. So how does one go about, you know...
Fighting the good fight?
Yeah.
There are people doing that. The way it was explained to me, correct me when I go wrong, Patty, is that charter schools affect Boston area, the eastern part of Massachusetts, so that's why it's such a big to-do, but choice schools do not, so they don't really get involved in it.
Choices is very regionalized to western Massachusetts and the Cape towns. So collectively, Western Mass and the Cape towns don't have the legislative power to get the $5,000 increase. The other towns, Worcester over, very wealthy towns, there isn't school choice. Their kids stay in their own towns because the school, the town next door is as rich as we are. There's no sense.
Many so, of them have multiple schools within the town,
correct.
So they're not leaving town. They're going to different schools,
correct.
But not necessarily leaving
right.
town.
So because it doesn't affect everyone, we get no attention.
But there are people fighting that.
I mean, our legislators are on it all the time. It's just like I said, we don't have the votes.
We had the votes in, well, I forgot, we had the election on September, October, where we voted down the charter school. So that was good for us. There was a lot of people behind that. You were, I was, a lot of people were. There's a lot of big groups out there that were behind it. Charlie Baker wasn't. He wanted more charter schools. Just remember that when you vote for him again.
There was one expansion of a charter school in Hadley that was denied by the state board two or three weeks ago, maybe a month ago.
Yes, sir.
Roy Cohn, I'm on the Conway Finance Committee. Just to be clear, I mean, honestly, so if they upped it to 7,500 choice, if it's same in and out, I don't think that that's really, maybe that's why it's kind of ignored. The bigger issue, I think, is the insane funding of the charter schools.
Yes. No,
I also think there's a fundamental problem of town money going to charter schools with no reporting back to the town.
Well, the thing is, they came about, you know, for many reasons, but one of the arguments they gave was, well, you know, if the school isn't meeting your kids' needs, before the charter school was really tough luck. Our parents' point of view. So I'm just playing the devil's advocate here. So if there was a charter school that you felt was meeting the kids' needs, you know, well, it's great from that point of view that it exists. Now, realistically, can we ever have a situation where we please all the people all the time? The answer is no. I mean, that's just human reality. And, you know, those were the days when there wasn't a choice and you sort of had to, you know, the focus had to be on the primary public school, if you will, primary district. So.
Paul?
Everything said is absolutely on the money. Never going to change. I mean, the likelihood of us having an impact at the state level is slim to none. What has to be done is having a product which is considered superior to the alternative. And I know that you can, you know, we can all sit back and say there's nothing we can do, but I'll tell you, if this was a for-profit private organization and the competition was eating your lunch, you would, this group right here would find a way over that hump, would find a way to position your product so that others want it and others won't leave.
That said, Frontier is actually in a very good situation as opposed to other schools, public schools in our area. So we actually do deliver a product, and some of us sitting at this table have children who went here and are very successful adults, and we ourselves went here and are very successful. So I think
that Frontier does deliver. It's just how can we deliver against unfair competition? And how can we level that playing field? And I think that's what's really important for us to all work together, is to get that playing field level. I don't care if a child goes to charter school, but I don't want them going to a charter school that's just a high school. I want them going there for a special reason. That's my own personal feeling.
If they thought they were going to that charter school for an inferior curriculum, they wouldn't go.
Right.
But they think they're going for superior curriculum.
And they're not.
And the reason is because they don't know what the curriculum is going to provide their child over time. And if you have a curriculum coordinator, and they were working for me, I can tell you right now, they would be advertising and they would be, I'd be holding them to task to make sure that children in all grades hit a certain points along the way, and that we run that up the flagpole. I mean, that's the only way this is going to change. And if you don't do that grade by grade by grade, then parents are just going to look at it and say, same old, same old, and I'm out the door, because they're spending everything they have on special needs kids coming through, but yet the kids that are at the top of the rung, the kids that are going to end up running the country downstream, I'm moving out.
Okay, and then Bob.
I don't disagree with the assertion of advertising or sending a message out, but I would point out that we have 150 students choicing in. So I think that there is a superior product. It is double, the students coming in are double the amount going out. However, the amount going out, this funding formula is so screwed up that there's nothing we can do. I mean, not to say there's nothing we can do about it. It puts us between a rock and a hard place.
Bob?
Sorry, but I really disagree with almost everything you guys are saying. I don't think you should assume that people who are sending their kids out are doing it out of ignorance. And you seem to feel that way. And people send their kids to another school for a lot of reasons, and the state studies generally show it's not academics, and it's all kinds of reasons you might disagree with, just like the reasons why kids come here. A lot of kids come here for great sports, and it has nothing to do with academics. People go to school choice because it's the school where their parents work, and they, you know, they like taking their kids to school, and they may be terrible reasons. Now, the money that you get for charter schools is very low compared to the money that you, I mean, for school choice compared to charter, which makes sense. The cost of Frontier to take in a school choice kid is virtually zero. The program is set up that way. It's pure profit for Frontier to take in a school choice student. And so the political pressure to significantly raise it would be tremendous. And once we have charter schools, they're not just tweaking kids between public schools, they're setting up a whole new school. And it makes sense that their tuition is about the same as the Frontier tuition. You know, how you could not run a school for 10,000 or 8,000 or however low you would like to make the charter school tuition. Fight charter schools. You know, try to get rid of charter schools. Talk to Baker. Politically, fight charter schools. But don't take it out on parents that are sending their kids to a charter school. And don't think the tuition is outrageous. The tuition is very reasonable.
Roy?
I just wanted to hear those numbers again from you. How many choice in? This is district-wide we're talking about, is that correct?
Just for Frontier?
Oh, is it? Well, for sure.
Seeing?
What is it?
137 students coming in.
Okay, that's choice.
And 82 total leaving, between 40 to school choice and 42 to charter.
Okay. And what, if you aggregated that district-wide, what would that be, including the elementary schools?
I can put that together.
Well,
I don't have it with me, but I can put it together.
I mean, you know, that's a good number coming in. You know, it attests to the desirability of many aspects of Frontier. There's no question. I agree with my colleague, Bob. The effort really should be spent on imitating some of what some of the charter schools are offering, and then you'll get, because as I can speak from experience, many times a parent goes through a lot of extra effort to send their kid to this charter school. It's not their first choice. Their first choice would be let the kid get a bus and come here. So, I mean, that's my, look carefully at what, where we're losing students to the charter schools. See what it is that they're really, because that's how they've set this up. And we should be very cold-hearted analysis of this thing. We want to get those kids back. So make it, give them a program that can get them back.
Bob Paula? Did you have your hand up?
No.
Bob Decker, sorry.
Yeah, I stand corrected if I'm wrong, but it's my understanding that we have a full spectrum of students at Frontier, including some with substantial learning disabilities, whereas you don't find that in the charter schools. And if it's my understanding, if they have them, they seem to get them exited out and backed into a public school or into an ed plan that somebody else picks up the tab. So you really can't compare dollars to dollars and kids to kids, because they're taking a different mix.
Again, I can speak from first hand down at Polo Freire Charter School in your town.
City.
You tell me, do they send the kids, do they kick the kids out that need special? No,
absolutely. Absolutely. Oh my God, I worked in Holyoke for 12 years when the charter school started. They all went, and every kid that was ELL and SPED were back in a month. They started at the charter school on September 1st, and by September 30th, we had every kid with an IEP and every English language learner right back in the Holyoke public schools.
And they kept the money.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
And their MCAS scores are no better.
That's my point. Is you really, you can't, they're not the same apples. All right, it's what we try to do here is the full spectrum, and they're just picking the fruit, the top fruit.
Mm. That's absolutely true.
Paul?
That's absolutely true. But in doing that, they are changing the social atmosphere in these schools.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
So over time, when I went to high school, I mean, I had friends whose parents were physicians and attorneys, public school. I'd like to know how many physicians and attorneys are sending their kids here. And in fact, we're down to the point now where even educators, teachers in this, I'm sure in this school, and I know in other schools, are sending their kids out to charter schools, they're sending them to private schools. It's getting to the point where the mix you have is becoming detrimental to the overall education of the average kid.
Keith,
sorry,
I apologize to you because you had your hand up and I kind of went over you, so.
So I've heard a few things. I just want to respond a little bit. I try to be very careful about where I'm targeting my views. I'm not questioning any parent that chooses to send their kids anywhere. I try to be very clear about that. If they live on town line, if they're very close, there's several reasons I would not question how a parent is going to choose to where they're going to educate their kid. How I would question the funding formula, and that's what I just want to keep my focus right on. What I've heard is they need the money to set up or to begin the charter. They're set up already. They're running, very much like Frontier is. So to say they need this tuition to start is, I would question that. And then I heard that we need to get programs here to draw those kids back. Well, that's the same thing as we need the money to set it up. So there's a balance here. And then the other thing about charters is they don't have to provide any transportation. So they're getting students of means. And then if you have students who, and I've seen this personally, students who don't have the means and would like to go can't. And I would be very, very careful about saying teachers sending their kids to charters and private schools without real facts.
No, I know teachers, I know educators, politicians, unless they live in Long Meadow or Newton, many of them sending their kids out. But yet they're making decisions on the public schools that our children are going to. which I think is.
And then on the other side of it, I mean, so we're going to go anecdotally. I work in a school where I know no one sending their kids to private or charter.
I'm sure.
There's
sure
a balance. Right. But from my, I want to keep it. My argument is clearly just the funding formula is inequitable.
Lynn?
I agree with what you're saying. I would point you all to the current federal administration, which has put forward a tentative budget which cuts $9.2 billion out of public schools and is diverting, I think, $266 million towards charter schools and $100 and something million towards school choice vouchers. Private school vouchers. What we need to be aware of is that the current federal administration is pretty much all about privatizing education. And they speak to the fact that it will help all of the particularly disadvantaged children. Well, the setup is not, it will not be equitable. The disadvantaged children will not be able to have transportation to these schools. They won't be able to achieve because they can't offer the specialized services, on and on. But we need to be aware of that because that's the climate that we're working in. And that is what we're working against. Not only are we working against a system that provides alternative education for whatever reason, and I don't believe at any higher quality than what we're doing. I would take our top 10%, wherever they're going, their SAT scores, their AP scores, and put them against any charter school and their scores. And I would do that in a heartbeat, and I know we would come out on top. As far as opportunities, we offer any class any student would like to take. We have VHS. We have those opportunities here. We have virtual high school classes. Again, I've been speaking to this, zoology, oceanography, anything any student would be interested in. We offer 11 AP classes, and we also have a very healthy and very active performing arts and visual arts program right here, as well as the sports. But I think that what we're working against right now is the federal administration and their agenda. And it may get worse before it gets better, if it does get better.
Judy?
Yeah, I feel like I'm backing up your point, Dr. Carey. It's a couple of times I thought I heard you say that the perception is that the students that are here at Frontier are not the cream of the crop, and I want to, because they're taking other opportunities in other schools, and I want to be a clear advocate for what you said, what is going on in this school. The opportunities for excellence in academics, sports, arts, they're all here. And to even like put out there the notion that the students in this school are not excelling, I think it does a tremendous disservice to the programs that are in this school, the people who teach the programs in this school, and the school committee that tries to support those services. I want to be really clear about that. I mean, these students are amazing. And the effort that they put forth every year, and the student and the teachers that support their ideas, as crazy as they may be, I mean, the first musical in 20 years.
Yeah.
That was a tremendous amount of work. You know, I mean, the AP offerings, it's here. These students are challenging themselves in ways that you cannot anticipate. Should we do a better job, or could we do a better job publicizing it? Yes, maybe we could. But the opportunity is here, and the students are here who are excelling. They
you're
are,
here,
and it is across the spectrum of kids in all levels of this within the school.
So, Roy, I'll give you, and then Paul, and then I'm going to ask if anybody has anything else about the budget, and then I think we should close this down and move it along. I think we're kind of all on the same page here. We're just we've got our
one
own
quick
opinions.
Question, Cindy.
But Roy first.
I just want to respond. I agree totally with what you say, but I would change one word. Instead of publicize, need to start thinking, and this is to help prepare for what's coming. The word is marketing. Okay. And my belief is, if this district is going to survive along with many other districts, you have to be focused like a laser on the excellence and and read the programming you can offer and know when you can't offer it because it's just not going to be any good because you don't have the resources. And then you need to market the daylights out of it. Now you may say, well, this is unheard of. Why do we have to market it? Because of the coming the push to privatize. On the one hand, they're going to push to privatize. On the other hand, there's going to be a mandate to have a non-private public school. And so, you know, we're going to be torn, you know, limb from limb. And that is the only, in my opinion, is the only hope that you can, because you can't quietly do these things and it's not just the usual a press release here or something. You've got to have marketing that is loud and is different perhaps than anything that the district has ever embarked on. And again, this is my opinion.
Paul?
I couldn't agree more. But to respond again, I believe you wholeheartedly. I also believe Dr. Carey when she talks about the SAT scores. Here's the problem. It's anecdotal. Every time there's a cheering section, every time there's, you know, there's all this support, it's anecdotal. And if you believe what you said, someone's going to have to ask you, prove it. Figure out how you prove it, but you have to prove it. SAT scores, mm-hmm. I believe you. Prove it. In public, mm-hmm. Black and white.
Yep.
Put it up on the board.
We do have that data.
Phil, breathe.
Phil, what time are you from again?
First of all.
Pumpkin Hollow?
Just close enough that it was scary. But so, first of all, you can actually do a search in Google. SAT scores by district in Franklin County, they'll all pop up for you. And you will see that ours are the best. And that they're better than the charter school. That they're better, that are the only one that's closest to us, Hampshire's closest to us, Amherst and Northampton are where we're competitive with. We're way above Greenfield and we're way above Mohawk. And we look really good. The other thing is, if I were to ask you, guess which local institution sent more last year's graduates to the Ivy Leagues, Frontier or Deerfield Academy? Answer.
We're going to guess.
I have to say Deerfield Academy because perception, and it's always anecdotal. And I'm sure what you're going to tell me is Frontier.
Right.
Well, when I walked in the door, that should have been looking me right in the face. But it's not.
And it's not just it's not just those attending. It should also be those who got accepted. Because the kids get accepted, they don't always go.
Absolutely.
Okay, you know, so again, I think we're all on the same page. And I really thank you for your input. All of it, seriously, we do. I don't think the answer can be found tonight, but I do know there's people fighting the good fight, and so I'm gonna now close the public hearing. Unless someone has something that's totally different than charter schools or choice schools to talk about, and we will take up, we'll have to vote it when it comes up further down our agenda. You're welcome to stay for the rest of our meeting, but Mary?
So I just had a question about the marketing, and it's a word, so what does that look like? And, you know, if we need to be having more discussions about that, I think it's a great idea.
Yeah, make notes.
But what does it look like? We need a line item for marketing. Sorry. but I think it's worth pursuing that.
Yeah.
Because we all know it, and, you know, lots of our townspeople do, but not everybody.
Yeah.
And several years ago, we actually did do some advertising, and we took a lot of heat for it.
Yeah, we got a lot of
grief. We took a lot of heat for it, and so we kind of went away from that. Because the public didn't want that.
Could
be different now.
This is at its start a monitor in the as you walk in that maybe has some school highlights. So, I didn't know the school. I mean, I don't get an opportunity.
So you walk into school and you see what the highlights of the school you're already at, right? If you have a monitor in your school, you've already the people who are walking in are in your school. So how's that marketed out?
Well, no, there's plenty of people.
No, you can market it inside because,
that's
to start with, you got a trophy case down there full of names and of great sports accomplishments. But, I mean, I don't see an academic show. I mean, maybe it's there. I haven't seen it. But
front and center.
Those are the kind of things that, you know, and as they change over time, you know, let everybody know.
Again, I made notes on that for marketing.
We're not just talking about, I'm not talking about an ad.
And you're offering to be on that committee, right? Are you offering to be on that committee?
Not necessarily, but
okay.
You know, there's tabletop shows that insurance companies, businesses go to. Whoa, here's our local school district there. Think of how refreshing that would be. You know, I didn't know that about Frontier or whatever. I mean, these things don't cost a lot of money, but you have to get more used to thinking in that sort of manner, and that's really all I can say.
And again, thank you again. And we will now move along to reviewing and approving the minutes of February 15th, 2017. Can I have a motion, please?
Give a motion to approve minutes.
Can I have a second? Did everybody have a chance to look them over? Hearing no discussion, all those in favor accepting the minutes? Opposed? Anybody have to abstain? One abstention. Financial statements.
I'm abstaining. Yeah, I was.
Patty pretty much went over them. Patty, do you have anything else to add to that?
I have quite a bit.
Oh my goodness, I apologize.
So tonight, first off, you have 23 warrants to sign in the amount of $1,435,655.45. I continued as requested. I'm adding notes to our financial statements every month. So we had a line item that was over budget, and we found out that the money was being spent from the principal's office for some tutoring that was happening with some of our ELL students. So we have reclassed $2,883 to stipends for other support services. The function code 2305, our teacher's classroom, we had made the manual entries to correct the situation, and the encumbrance was supposed to auto-correct. It didn't. So we have a call in to Infinite Visions to help us fix that. And also from your
Patty,
meeting.
Does that have some kind of financial importance?
No, why, it just makes it one line's over and one line short by 19,000 because I can't get the encumbrance to flip to the right line. Technically, when I change the account line funding, the encumbrance should follow it, and it's not doing it. There's a disconnect. So I've got to get them on the phone. And then on the January 24th meeting, your school committee approved the transfer of $15,000 from tuition to collaboratives to a expense for extraordinary maintenance for the library roof project. That entry has been made as well. Okay, now, a couple other things that we need to talk about tonight. OPEB. So we interviewed three different firms for investing our money for an OPEB trust, and we're recommending that we go with Bartholomew and Company. They are a quasi-local company. They're based in Worcester. Their fees are very straightforward and very low compared to the other places that we looked. And the thing that gives them the gives us the real boost, they're offering to give us the basis points based on not just our money, but also if any of our towns have money on deposit with them. So we have a measly $100,000, but if another town has their money there, our 100 will get pooled with theirs and we'll get the basis points on the higher rates. No one else is offering us that. One of our towns already has money on deposit with this company. It is my understanding that another one will be opening an OPEB trust with this company. So we'll have two of our towns that are also in here. So I think it is in our best interest to put our OPEB money with Bartholomew. I did discuss, this was done by the treasurer, Paula Light, and myself, and we did discuss it with Tom Scanlon, our CPA, and he concurs with our decision that this would be a great place. The one thing that we would like some input on, and we'll bring it back in April, is the investment savings. Because this is long-term money, we can take very different routes. And what we would like the school committee to vote on the investment policy statement, we're going to recommend that we go with the aggressive moderate fund, but we would like your approval on that. So I will get this information as to the hypothetical asset allocation table. They have a conservative, a moderate, conservative, aggressive moderate, and aggressive. And again, it's long-term money, so I think we can take more risk. Then like our scholarship funds, which we can't. I will get this out to you, and then we will be bringing the IPS to you in April or May for your consideration.
Is it going to be real clear what all those management fees are?
Wait, let her finish, please. Let her finish. We're trying not to do that anymore. Patty, sorry.
And now I'm throwing off track. I forgot my other points. Hang on, let me see. Yeah, because maybe it'll
go ahead, Phil. Please don't do that again.
She had paused. That was a perfectly appropriate question.
I had asked you at the beginning to raise your hand and be recognized. So go ahead and ask your question now, please.
Oh, I forget what it was.
Oh, God.
And I forgot mine because I was thrown off track.
My hand was raised before his. But anyway, my question is, what kind of security do we have that this outfit doesn't go broke? And another Bernie Madoff type thing. Is it federally insured or anybody backing up our deposits so that
I can find that out?
Well, that's what concerns me. I mean,
so you want to track them?
So they're managing over $925 million in assets for over 200 municipalities in the Commonwealth. They range in size from $1 million accounts to $50 million accounts.
We've already put $100,000.
Correct.
So far.
Yeah, but the point I'm trying to make is I want to make sure that we don't get, you know, all of a sudden find somebody filed for bankruptcy and we're getting.
Here's their list of industry awards. They are in America's top wealth advisors. They're in the top 1,200 financial advisors in America. They're in the top 1,000 financial, again, in America for 2013, 12, and 10. Top 30 for 16, 15, and 14.
That's great.
I didn't know I was going to have that.
But my point is, if something goes sour, is anybody going to bail us out?
So noted.
Oh, I just remembered the other point. The other thing with Bartholomew Company, they have a trust agreement that's already drafted, and we would be allowed to use that. They've copyrighted it, and so we would not have to incur the legal fees of establishing the trust documents. That was the other benefit.
So we'd still need counsel to look at it.
Absolutely.
Okay, Judy?
I think what Phil wanted to ask, and what I would like to ask too, is if I could understand. First, I'd like to see the investment portfolio options and also the underlying funds within it, whether or not they're private label funds or whether they're commercially available funds. I'd like to see the basis point breakdowns based on the sliding scale, based on how many people in our four town group invest. And I want to understand the other fees.
So Judy, those are all great questions.
And you could just hand me the book if you want to.
Yeah, I will do that.
Okay.
But just so you know, the power to invest lays with the treasurer. You've given her that duty. So it's her decision.
I understand. I have 22 years in the mutual fund record keeping industry, and so I can do a deep dive in it pretty quick.
And
just for my own curiosity.
Just so you know, there is
that back.
Municipalities is what we can invest in defined by Mass General Law, and I can give you those. And there is what they call the legal list, and companies apply to be on the legal list to invest. And that they're following the same types of investment that would happened with no matter who we went with, because it is public money in the Commonwealth. But I'd be happy to share.
I understand the framework. I'm not trying to, like, super.
If it would make you guys comfortable, I could have the gentleman come in May and do a presentation to you.
That would be fine with me. Anybody else?
Yeah, I would like to say I do again appreciate your level of preparation for tonight and letting us know that this is something we're going to vote on in April and May, and that not just being presented tonight for a vote tonight. So, you know, having that presentation could be helpful.
Okay, so I'll talk to the gentleman and we'll schedule that for May. Okay, the last thing I have for tonight is in regards to an update on the lights donation in the amount of $85,764.65. While we were moving, I figured, since I'm packing, I might as well go searching. And I went into the bowels of 219 Christian Lane, and I call them the bowels for a reason.
Yes.
And I was able to find documentation that we spent well over the $85,000 that was donated. We actually spent over $100,000 putting lights on the Frontier football field. I presented all that information to our attorney and asked his opinion as to if we could utilize this money. And his opinion was that since we have the documentation that we spent over the donated amount, and there is no organization to return the money to, they don't exist, and I don't know if they were ever a formal 501(c) corporation, a not-for-profit registered, he said, talk to your accountant, because I think, based on school committee vote, those funds could be utilized. So, when I had Mr. Scanlon in the office talking about the OPEB trust, I said to Tom, this is our attorney. He's kicking it to you. What do you think? And he said that he didn't have an issue with it. And in fact, DOR is pushing cities, towns, schools to get these dormant funds off their books. So that's $85,000. I think what I would like before you guys vote is that we get a legal written opinion from our attorney, and then we could possibly use this $85,000 for an oil tank or a roof or anything else we might need. And that is my presentation for tonight, Ms.
Okay.
Bob?
Question. Did we not go to court already on this?
No.
We talked to somebody or something.
Yep. Years ago, we talked to Donna McNichol, and she was supposed to file a petition of Cypre, and she never did.
She never did it?
Yep. And when I talked to our counsel about petitioning the Cypre, he says that he does not think that that's necessary, because we have the documentation that we spent the money. We used actual other funds to pay for the money, and the donations have just been sitting there.
Yeah, but we also got reimbursement from the state of school building assistance. So are we net in there over the $85,000?
I don't know that, Bob.
Okay,
I'm just going with the attorney said.
Wasn't Lori Bronis one of the spearheaded people involved with this whole thing?
Correct. I tried to call her. She was out of the country for the month of December.
Well, you know, I don't want to do an end run. I'd like to be up front. And maybe if we show it to her, maybe she'll back off. And
I don't think Ms. Baronis has any issues. I mean,
unless you've heard something we haven't heard.
Right. Well, I mean,
I know that Superintendent Barrett had met with her.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say.
And the conversation was that that we would expand the lighting to other parts of the field. And Superintendent Barrett explained that Frontier nor its neighbors wanted any more lighting on our fields.
But
so what,
I just don't want to try to pull an end run.
I hear you.
You know, people gave that money. I didn't have to contribute, but a lot of people did contribute, and some people gave substantial monies. And I wouldn't want to pull an an end run. I mean, I know what happened is we included it in the cost of the building, and we got reimbursed, in a school aid formula. So, but I don't really want to.
So what I'm hearing from Patty is that she's asking for legal advice, and she's already asked for some, but she wants a written.
So, Cindy, let me just back it up. Mr. Decker asked me to get the legal opinion, and now we got the legal opinion, and he still thinks we're pulling an end run. So I don't understand the logic here.
But I still think that you had people that put this whole package together, and I don't want to pull an end run. You might just send her a letter and say, unless we hear differently, this is how we'd like to proceed.
But our lawyer's telling us we don't need to do that.
I know. So I think what
it wasn't an individual that gave us the money.
Bill? All right, I think what Bob might be referring to is a feeling of an end run around the person most responsible for raising the money, not the law. I know that family, one of the things, since it was raised for lighting, if we could make a commitment to actually fix the lights first, like actually, replace the ones that are burnt out, and there's like a few lights that don't work as well. That's what I was told.
Not that I'm aware of.
All right.
Could it
be switched to LEDs?
If there's no issue with the lights, then she's not going to have a problem, and it's all good.
Right. Bob?
My opinion is, and I understand we have neighbors here and stuff, but a lot of these, if you have nighttime functions going on in the spring and summer, it's light already till 8:30 at night. The lights wouldn't come on until probably the last part of the game that we would have. I think we should put the money towards more lights for softball and for baseball. If the money was for lights originally, and if somebody has a problem, and somebody else has a problem, Lori has a problem, that we're putting on the softball field or the thing, at least we're using it on lights.
That's what she wanted. But the committee, my direction was the committee would like to use the funds for something else. I was sent in that direction to get advice, and now I'm hearing you want to use it on light. So I'm just a little confused as to why I'm making all these phone calls.
If it was raised for lights, I'm suggesting that we keep it on lights. If somebody has another use for it.
Judy?
Patty, did I mishear you when you said that we spent the money and more on the lights as originally intended?
I found the original contract that was awarded to the bidder to put the lights in, and I believe it was like $145,000, and we had $85,000 donated.
Yeah, I don't see why it's an issue then. I think
I would like to see it in writing.
I would like to see it in writing too. I agree with your request that we get a written legal opinion on the matter, but if we spent the money as directed, but the money is there because we didn't transfer the funds from one place to another, or whatever the mechanism is, then in the legal opinion corroborates that information, then.
What, Damon first? Damon?
What I don't understand is if we have $85,000 and it costs $115,000, why do we still have $85,000?
Because they were building, they were doing a renovation through the MSBA program at the time, and they used those funds instead of the actual cash.
Okay.
And my predecessor, his idea was that he was going to use that money to make the last bond payment and take that off the town's assessments. Well, when he retired and I came on and I presented that idea to our attorneys, who are different now, they said that's absolutely illegal, cannot do that, cannot use that donated money to make the last payments. So then that's when we've started, well, what can we use it for? And do you have to file the petition of CyPRE? Well, we would like to file the petition of CyPRE. Never happened. So now we're back at square one. We've got $85,000. We've got lots of needs. And how do we utilize that?
Phil? So one quick money-saving suggestion. Instead of requesting a written opinion from the lawyer, you can send a letter to the lawyer recounting in writing the contents of your previous conversation.
Yes.
And that's, he doesn't have to bill you for, he or she doesn't have to bill
He's
you for
He's on retainer. They don't bill us.
They bill us anyways.
I mean, they bill us. They don't bill us for extra. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We're
send
paying.
A letter. Yeah. Okay.
Lynn?
I'm curious if some of this funding, if we receive a written opinion from a lawyer, if we could use some of this funds, some of these funds for the roof project that we're talking about tonight.
Well, I thought that was the whole purpose of starting all these conversations, because you want the school committee, it was the desire of the school committee to use those funds for some of our issues.
Mary?
So at the time that the building was built and the field was designed, we spent a lot of time on where the lights were going to go, what fields, what the plant, you know, we interviewed all the coaches and teams and what do people want, but also the neighbors. Neighbors had a lot to say because those lights are bright at night.
They're
so
bright. Before we even full disclosure,
before we even talk about adding more lights, I mean, it's not a quick decision to do that, I think.
I did find your name on a lot of documentation.
I bet you did. Oh, I bet you did.
From day one. Okay, so it was at...
That's it. That's all I have.
Okay, so thank you very much. Public comment. And Student Advisory Council,
yay,
come to the table.
Yeah.
Thank you for staying.
Yeah, of course. My name is Angela Self. I'm a junior representative for the Student Council. Basically, our big project is that we're trying to do a field day in May, and we're going to talk to Mr. Modesto about the date and time next week. Basically, we just do a bunch of games. It's a fun time at the end of the year for all the students, and it's after all the AP exams. It's just good. Do you guys have any questions?
How long is that field day going to be?
Usually, this is a big debate.
We're here to help.
We're trying to get a full block. It's
like a whole hour?
Yeah.
Oh, no, it's an hour and a half a block?
It's an hour and a half.
Oh.
We have 15 minutes right now. We're trying to extend that, but...
Half a day! 3 hours! Come on!
I have countered with they can show me an hour's worth of planning, they can have an hour's worth.
Wow.
So that's the planning has to mean the time. It's idle hands.
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree with you.
The entire school outside
I
is
totally agree
more
with
than
that.
The Devil's Playground.
But that could be one of our marketing situations.
It is
marketing's field day.
Their field day is a fun day. We have garage bands going on and different events going on. It's a good time to get out kind of a spring kind of
thing for a
community thing. But yes, I
am. Killing me, Smalls. That's my only question is how we can extend your 1.5 hour field time to an actual maybe half day.
Yeah, we're trying to plan.
They're trying to get an hour and a half.
Oh my God!
You've been just overruled. It's a half day.
We may have to take.
Oh my God! They're going to get a proclamation. It's going to be over.
Yeah. So if you can come back with more information on that, that'd be great. But okay. A little bit longer than a block.
That's about it right now.
And thank you for staying.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you
very
thank
much.
Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions? Thank you. You know that bothers me. Okay, so in unfinished business, we are just going to... Bob Holla hates it when I flip things around, so we're just going to flip... Did you hear that sigh? Flip B for A, so we're going to talk about the Frontier Library Media Center, and Tom Hartman has been so kind to sit and listen to everything else, and he's here tonight with Bob to explain some things to us. So you both have the floor, and thank you very much for coming.
Basically, the last meeting I was here, funding for me to hire somebody to really verify some of the things that I saw from the group. We were able to Hartman Architects working on this really quickly. They've done a great job. I think they really understand the problem. They're going to present to the group a range of options. It goes from stopping the leaks that absolutely have to be done to dealing with some big energy issues and then some safety things that are important but not essential. But Tom's got a good grasp on what we're going to do, and he did a great job outlining it. I think he's got
I really like your PowerPoint presentation.
You like that
one too. I do.
I like people to pay attention to me, not the computer. So,
So we're in Amherst, Massachusetts, and a six-person firm. We work all over New England anymore. We specialize in high-performance buildings. We work a lot with Amherst, Williams, Smith. We do a lot of institutional kind of tricky projects to help us figure this out work. And so I got introduced to Bob through Gary Hartwell at Smith, who we do a lot of, I guess you could even call house doctor work. So Bob asked us to think about the problem. I don't know, did you guys hear the wind?
Yes, yes. Oh, yeah. I was watching your eyes.
There. You shouldn't hear that in a building. And so...
Well, Halloween is good.
Yeah, that means it's connected to the outside. And so he asked me to think about this comprehensively, you know, with the understanding that there's a budget to do new finishes in here, there's some work that's going to happen, there's that wonderfully biologically active ceiling tile right out there that happens to be directly below this roof drain, okay? And so this is up in, anybody ever been up here?
No, actually, I shouldn't say that.
Darius is can
we
poke
were
his,
up there in
Darius
pictures.
Can poke his head through.
It feels like we were up there. We had a very good slideshow.
It's not what I would do. So this is the roof drain. There's plastic wrapped around it, and there's a bucket system that's possible to get to. This is a view from the mechanical pad up there where you can see the light from above. Mm-hmm. That's not supposed to be like that. And then, interestingly, we were looking at why these panels are corroding on some orientations and not on other orientations. The panels themselves are a steel panel. They're original to the building. They look like they're in good shape. They don't appear to be leaking in a, you know, catastrophic way. And the only thing we can figure, I mean, literally in this back corner, on one side it's perfectly fine. On the other side, it's tainted. The only thing we can imagine is there were two crews, and there's a finished side for an exterior that has an additional coating. That's not on, because the back side is the same color, and one crew put it on wrong.
Wrong one. Oh, wow.
So my thought on this in particular is you could spend a fair bit of money and make it worse. You're the paint expert. You'd have to do a lot of prep on this to get this right. And you'd have to put a high-performance coating on there that might not last that long.
Maybe.
So leave it alone.
That's my first thought on this particular issue. You know, there's an aesthetic point to that, but probably nobody's really complaining about it. And if you were going to spend a significant amount of money, you might as well just replace it with better panel. So that being said, what we did here is we really looked at this in these tiers. There's five tiers. And the first thing is fix the leaks. It's very easy to do. So for some reason, this is 1970, right? This is 1980. They like to do this for some reason at that time period with rooms. I don't know why. I like this better. I'm really complicated. So somebody went up there and tried to fix it, and it looks like there's a flat patch of rubber membrane. And really what we're thinking, the first order of business, this is a roof plan, is to, so this is the roof coming down, this is the roof coming up. You put something called a cricket in there, like you have behind a chimney, so that the water comes down and it gets pushed out that way, and the water comes down and pushes out that way. Abandon the roof drain. Just put a cricket in there. Then there's around the perimeter of where the flat roof is, there's some membrane flashing that should be redone because there's some evidence of leaking around the perimeter. And you know, the first thing to say, these numbers, we had an estimator look at this. We did conceptual design. We did enough drawings to throw numbers at this. I'm sure you guys have all been through construction projects to know that, you know, numbers move. But I think these are good enough to make decisions. So we're thinking $18,500 or so to do that work, to build a cricket, fix the perimeter flashing. You know, it's a small job. Would you get competitive bidding? You know, that whole process on it. But that's the first order of business. make that nasty ceiling tile go away. You know, I think that's plainly obvious. The second thing to do, and if you look at this detail here, there's only about 6 inches of curb between the bottom of the window and the roof. And there's some evidence up there that someone's going up there to try and tape it and to fix it. You can see in this window the gasket, there's one gasket that's left. And so our recommendation would be to actually raise that, replace all this glass, raise that curb another 12 inches so it's 18 inches and reflash it properly. We think that's about $22,000. You know, and so there's two kind of discrete projects there that I think are going to make some improvements. Now, here's the big one, which is upgrading the lighting in the ceiling and creating an air barrier up in the roof plane. Just to kind of show you what it looks like up top. You should hear that. So this is a plan. So here's the elevator. This right here is the slope of the roof that's coming up right in the middle there. And, you know, you go up this ladder here, and you can stand on this pad with a piece of mechanical equipment, and you really have to work to get yourself out into that space. It's dangerous, quite frankly. You can easily fall through the ceiling. And there's an opportunity here. This is the section. So this is the clear story here, and then this flat roof that is like a U-shape that comes all the way around. There's an opportunity here to replace the ceiling, put in new lights, put in new LED lighting, and pursue incentives for that, and create an air barrier. So with buildings, there's really three components of an envelope: an air barrier, a vapor retarder, and insulation. You don't have an air barrier. That's why you can see the lights. Fiberglass is up there. So what we think is really the best way to do this is, you can't really do it from above, and I won't get too technical here, but if all the ceiling comes down, there's steel structure in there that you could create a new ceiling framing system and put drywall in from the underside. An air barrier is anything you can stick in your mouth and you can't breathe through. Right? Now, this is a non-combustible building, so it would need to be metal and gypsum wallboard. So we add this framing in here and we create this air barrier. The existing registers and ductwork and all that stuff would be retained and it'd be dropped down. Then we put a new ceiling in at the same level it is now with new lighting, and then we fill above this new air barrier with cellulose insulation. Just fill it full. Put like R40 insulation up there. Then where we have the clear story, there'd be closed cell spray foam sprayed underneath the roof deck. And this is, you know, this is a pretty significant project. That's about $170,000. Half of it is the insulation package, half of it is the lighting and the ceiling. And you know, you could go through and not do that, but I think this is the opportunity for this to be fixed. There would be some pretty significant energy savings along with that. I haven't calculated it, but I imagine when it's 10 degrees outside, it's cold in here.
So, I'm cold now.
Yeah, it's a little chilly. So that's $170,000, okay? On page 2 here, on the back side. So the next tier would be to really create, because now if we put this air barrier and we put insulation, it should be cold up there. Middle of winter. It should be the same temperature as it is outside. I'll bet you it's probably running about 50 degrees because all the cold air is running up through. So this mechanical equipment is there. We would propose to put a little enclosure around that pad that's up there to essentially upgrade the controls, the motors, tune that existing air handler up a little bit, provide a little bit better lighting up there. That's about $21,000 to do that. I think $7,500 of it was the controls piece. And then the last piece would be really to put this catwalk system in. With this enclosure, put a door from that mechanical space out onto the roof. and then to have a ship's ladder in the janitor's closet, which actually accesses the roof right now. That's an old steel bar, very dangerous ladder, so that you could go up that ladder, across the roof, and into this mechanical space without having to go up this ladder that's in this room here. That would still remain, but you know, that would be when you don't want to go outside. And then you don't have to break that little piece that you have right at the edge, piece of wood. So, you know, that's $51,000 to do all that work, the access, the catwalk. So the total project range is $280,000 to $300,000. And again, you could choose to take them in that order. I think tier one and tier two, you need to do it. After that, it's kind of a return on investment for tier three in terms of the energy. And then tier four and five are, you know, just doing it right. So that's really kind of the thought we had on how to approach this.
Bob?
Question. The figures you've got here, are these using prevailing wages that we'd have to hire?
Yes.
Second paragraph, Bob.
So that's the hard cost, 12% general conditions, 15% soft cost, fees and so forth, and a 15% contingency.
Okay, my next question is, we heat this building with natural gas, although we have the ability to heat with oil. The natural gas company, will they give us some sort of this incentive?
They may.
And if we switch to LEDs, is Eversource going to give us an incentive?
They may. Yeah. I mean, we
routinely... How hard is it to lock those numbers up?
Just call the reps and ask them.
Those numbers aren't hard to find out.
Yeah.
They're not huge. Now, you know, the incentive programs are getting a little bit smaller. You know, we're liable to pick up 5 or 10% of the total project costs from incentives.
Is the work to get that worth it?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. We've done a lot of work, and we've gotten good incentives.
I just don't want to spin our wheels for,
yeah, I know.
For a little margin. That's my question.
Darius first, and then Bill.
Right. Is there any way to figure out, I mean, I'm just amazed. I'm in here in the summer. If I remove one of those tiles, it's 110 degrees you put your hand up. Is there any way to talk about what the R rating between of these tiles and the amount of, is there a kind of formula that can say, like, the amount of energy that this room, with the square footage above it, that's with the R rating of whatever that tile is. I don't know. I'm talking outside my league, but I mean, I didn't know if there's an easy way of saying, like, we're just leaking massive amount of energy, both cool and, I mean, we have the AC in here all summer because of where our summer programs are. You know, I don't know. I was just thinking about, you know, I'm trying to obviously sell that kind of that view as well, but I just can't believe that that's all that's protecting us between us and the elements outside.
So the only R factor is the ceiling tiles.
There's fiberglass up there, but it's
insignificant.
It's all over the place.
You see the light coming through it.
Yeah, it's all over the place.
See it?
You know, it's peeled back, and I would say your R value there is maybe an effective 5, maybe 10. When you do a new house, you're usually putting in R40. Commercial buildings usually R30, something like that. So you could make it 3 or 4 times better by doing this. But it's not just the R value, it's the air barrier.
Right.
The air barrier is by far away the most effective way of doing this. And if the plan would be to put a lighting upgrade in here and upgrade the ceiling tiles and all that kind of stuff, it would be kind of an obvious opportunity to do it. I'd also like to say, you know, the insulation sitting on this grid that's here isn't a good thing either. It's not heavy, but it's, you know, these grids are not really designed to take all that stuff, and it's just a mess.
If our leaks get more significant, that insulation could become very heavy.
Right.
But the roof's not leaking, it's just the roof drain.
Bill?
So, maybe I missed it, but I didn't hear you address sort of how what impacts the elevator and our history of elevator repairs and how the space above and around the elevator can be made from gumming up the works again.
I don't know anything about that, but the elevator over travel is up here and the shaft wall comes up to a concrete slab on top of it. So anything that's dealing with the elevators below that plane.
was just pointing it out on the map where it was. He didn't
right.
really say anything.
Well, I had thought that there was an issue with the building envelope affecting the space in the top. That's why it was. That's why it broke. That the winter coming. Whatever. I don't know. That's what I thought. Just going back to your thing. The first two are mandatory?
No.
I mean,
nothing's mandatory.
Right, right. But the first two are like, gotta do.
Yeah. Sure. If it was my house, I'd do it.
Right. And three is where the options start, kinda?
I don't think we have options.
I was trying to.
Yeah.
I wasn't clear about it.
Like, what order?
What order you
do you want to save yourself?
Right. Can I add some information based on what we just heard?
Sure.
Because I've been waiting to see what our cost was going to come in at. So at this construction cost, we'd have to go through two bid processes because we would have to do a designer selection first. And then after we got the designer, then we'd have to bid the project. So it is a two-step bid process. And then because the construction cost, it would also have to be DCAM certification and filed sub-bids. Which gets a little bit more complicated. I did speak to our attorney about a warrant article to the towns, and when Lynn and I had that conversation, he said, why wouldn't you do a borrowing and have the towns approve that? Why would you be hitting them with the cost of the capital? He said most regionals that he deals with, they do a borrowing, and then the towns can pay it over 10, 20 years and not get hit with a third of $300,000 in 1 year. So I just want to throw that out there for your consideration while you're discussing this issue.
But to go along with this, the bidding thing you just talked about, Patty, are we going to talk about 40% more than the bottom line here just to hire all those people?
Well, designed, I think Mr. Hartman did a great job with his estimates for the actual construction. The design phase is a little bit different. We'd have to set the fee before. So, and I don't know if you included that when you say your soft cost.
No, that was just thinking about what you would need to spend on your end.
Right.
So
that I think the designer selection piece would be on top of that.
How do we avoid that?
How do we avoid it? We don't.
That's my question.
Well, how would we avoid it? One of the things at this price level is we would submit this to the MSBA, and they do all that work for you.
Judy?
I just wanted to know what the break point is that sort of causes that whole chain reaction of events that you just described.
Okay, it's if your estimated construction cost is exceeds $100,000. And then the next level after that is exceeding $10
million.
So I think, you know, we have a good idea of what's going on. I would rather not submit this to Commonwealth to get for the funding. We're looking at something, although, you know, to Bob's point, our roof is not leaking. We're looking at an opportunity to improve our building, to market our building, to improve our building over the long term. And if at 10% of what we just spent across the street to fix a roof, we're going to be able to realize long-term benefits.
There's
of
one
this.
More square there.
Darius?
So two questions for you. One is the air handler. Is it an 1982 air handler? And with the upgrades, the original talk was that if you're going to get up there, that's the only way you really can access the air handler, and we need cranes and all this other stuff, and you got to get in there. If it's getting close to its retirement age, then perhaps we have to put it down. No, but so you understand what I'm saying. But so you were talking about, you know, going and fixing it, or just kind of, what is the age? What are your thoughts on the air handler?
It's original, isn't it? It was 1980, which is in between the. But my feeling after spending some time up there with John and his ideas, especially the little mechanical companies,
suddenly, if we build that little partition and a door from the roof, we have really good access to that. The project we have currently in here is to keep the air handler itself and clean the coils and redo the controls and that sort of stuff. And to some extent, having better access from the doorway through the roof resolves the issue that I had about.
Because I was wondering, what's the life expectancy of a commercial air handler? You know, that was the question. So if you have, you know, you make it last another 5 years, you know, is that something I should be addressed now, or is it, can you get 10 more years out of it? And that really is something you put off. And that was the only question I had, because that was one of the things that we originally tied in as one of the issues.
I don't know. I mean, that's pretty old, but I've seen air handlers that are running since the 70s. They're not very efficient, but they're robust. And, you know, replacing that air handler would be, well, not only that, how do you get it out?
Well, that was one of the original.
Cut out the side and all that kind of stuff.
That was one of the original questions, is if you were going to open everything up. Yeah, your plan doesn't open it up as we originally were thinking was going to happen, was that we'd have access to it. And would we do it at that point? And so I don't even know, new air handlers may be a quarter of the size, you know, I imagine, right, compared to what's up. And what's up there is like a car, guys. When you see this thing, it's a car. Bam.
Is that what you hear?
Yeah, that's
is that it. What we hear, the air handling system, yeah, every time we're up here?
Yeah, it seems like you're on a Battlestar Galactica.
The, Bob Decker.
Could you possibly abandon the existing air handler and put in a freestanding one up there? You know, would there be sufficient strength of the floor to handle it?
Yeah, because everything is sitting on top of the concrete block stairwell. So yeah, there's a pad there.
Okay.
That it all sits
so up. We wouldn't have to take the old out. We just have to make arrangements to get.
Oh no,
the
you'd
new
have
one.
To take the old one out all right. to put a new one in.
There's all right, that was my question.
Yeah,
could
there's
you
not
just
enough room.
Right. I'm just trying to.
You can cut it up though. If you're not using it.
Yeah.
Bob Hollow just said the same thing, Darius.
Does anyone have objection to having Paul have a comment? I know this is a committee meeting and public moment's over, but
sorry,
I have no
have
problem
to fund
with
it.
Him.
Exactly.
But I have to ask you, if there's anybody who is not in agreement, let me know now. Paul.
Thank you. The picture chart that you have, they had up there earlier, that you had one in back, the lower right-hand corner, your recommendation is to pull that sill out, bring that sill up to 18 inches and replace the glazing. Prior to that, you had talked about the panels on top that cosmetically, they don't look great, but you feel confident that those panels should stay?
Stay or be replaced entirely. Yes.
So is that part of that?
No, we're just leaving that alone at this time.
But if you did replace that sill and the glazing, those tiles are good?
These tiles down here? Yeah, because we would basically build a new curb. We flash it with new sheet metal, and then we roll it over the new roof, over the existing roof. This would all stay the same from here above.
And that is good.
I think so.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, he's right. You know, and I found from somebody else when they built this, where they built it, must have been a night shift and a day shift. Somebody put the outside panel on the inside, and the inside on the outside.
Yeah.
I mean, it wouldn't. There's no other answer for that. Because the back of the place looks the same way. Everything else looks perfect.
Well, where was the project manager overseeing this? Where was the clerk of the works?
Moving on, Darius.
So, yeah, just blame the architect. Come on.
The only other thing
I don't blame the architect.
I asked Bob.
Over there, look at the plaque on the wall.
Pay attention.
When I talked to Bob earlier, is that if we're going to do all that, let's just look down for a second, and should we be replacing the carpet as part of this project? Because then you're really, then we're all of a sudden, besides the paint on the walls, we have a new facility. And if we're going to do all that work above, and this carpet is within a year, it's past its prime. I asked Bob, I don't know if you got that number for tonight, but I was asked if we could add that number, because then we have a new, basically you've done the whole thing. You know,
there's a lot of carpet. There's about 9,000 square feet of carpet.
Great.
In here. And the cost of carpeting, commercial carpeting, is somewhere between $3.50 and $6 a square foot, depending on the quality you buy. So we're talking a project of somewhere $35,000 to $45,000 to recarpet this whole library.
But what you're saying is you have everything out of here, right? Because you'd have to take everything out of here.
I mean, if you look down, I mean, the carpet's getting threaded in points. It's, you know, it's 20-something years old, so, or older. I don't know what.
How long, if we chose to do this project, from once we started to do something here, physically, how long would it take to turn it around, assuming we bought all five things?
What's your timeline?
What's the time? What would the timeline be? 2 months?
For construction?
Yeah, can we do it during school vacation in the summer?
With proper planning, yeah. Okay. I mean, the unfortunate part of the process that is set up for public entities is you don't have the benefit of getting somebody involved in pre-construction to vet these numbers, to vet the strategies. It all has to be put together and put out there, and then you get the lowest qualified eligible bidder with filed sub-bids.
Qualified.
Great.
Qualified.
Yeah, qualified at the discretion of the awarding authority. So, you know, what I think is an important thing to do also is to, if you have contractors that you've worked with that you have the opportunity to get them to look at this through their eyes and check our numbers. You know, we did the conceptual work. I'm sure we missed something. I guarantee we missed something in here. But, you know, we put a pretty tight range on that. And I think it's in the context of also, today people are pretty busy. Bob and I had this conversation earlier that we're seeing in private work, some estimates and bids are coming in higher than we thought because people are busy. And so that's what happens. So, you know, just take what we've given you here with that perspective. This is very quick conceptual work. It could be more. We could be right on. But we did our best to put that estimate together line by line and see where the numbers came out.
I notice on tier two, it says includes allowance for hazmat and the glazing, so I know that that's not a good situation. So, you're sure that's going to have to include some hazmating, or
no,
that's
I have
just
no
a
idea.
Question? Okay,
but
so you're just building that into it?
Given the vintage of that glazing,
it's probably
something.
Okay.
So.
Well, that adds to the timeline also.
So, Cindy, Bob? What it looks like is about, you know, this is 300. Going through the state and all the other stuff that we've got to do, and throw the carpet in there, you're talking close to $500,000. Mm-hmm. And you could bid it, you could borrow the money over, pay it off over 10 years at $50,000 a year plus whatever the interest costs were. Mm-hmm. And that's probably a good thing to do.
I'm not against taking out a loan. I don't know if anybody else is against taking out a loan. I just want to do it right.
Oh, I do too. I want to make sure they can't second guess.
I mean, is this the way we should go, or should we take it all out and get everything out while it's all open up, like you've been talking?
I mean, that's the whole next problem is, what if this doesn't happen during the summer, what do you do with the library, which is used by hundreds of students every day?
Yeah.
You know, so it's, you know, we got to, that's going to be proper claim.
Well, it wouldn't happen this summer, Darius.
Well, I understand that. Yeah.
I'd sort of like to suggest it. I would argue that fixing the leaks is a separate project from the envelope work, and that I believe it's under the threshold, or maybe we can just do it. You know, I think that's something to seriously consider. Again, that's what I'd do if it was my house.
So we could do one and two, or one?
Just do one for now.
Yeah. And then,
right, we'd have to get three bids. That's all.
Exactly.
To fix the leaks.
Right.
Bob and I do that every day.
Yep.
Well,
go ahead. You may speak.
With the, providing we get the legal written opinion, we do have some dormant funds that we could apply to this if, in fact, it's only $18,000.
Well, we transferred over how much? $15,000, was it? And then we hired this gentleman, and how much was that, Bobby? The work he's done.
$14.99.
The work he's done is about $6,000.
$6,000. So
it's not even going to be that.
Pardon me?
It's not even going to be that much.
I'm liking you more and more.
Yeah, yeah. Tell us more.
So basically,
he buys his
we got about $9,000 of what we moved aside. So all we had to do was find another nine, or another $10,000, and we should be able to do that. Any more money in that account that I found that money in?
Okay. You're the finder of the funds, Bob. You keep digging.
Oh, I'm just saying.
I'll sit in my office. I got nothing else to do.
I'd rather see us try to get the lawyer to give us a letter about that light money.
I just have one more.
Maybe we can do a few things with that light money.
Okay, Lynn. Lynn's got the floor.
Hi, Mr. Hartman. Quick question. Tier 1 says reflash sill at Clear Story's windows, leaving existing windows as is. If we went to Tier 2, replace glazing at the Clear Story windows or Clear Story and raise the sill to 18 inches. So we can't do both. We can't leave the windows as is and then come back in a couple, like a year, and then do tier two to raise the sill. What do you suggest? Do we raise the sill at the same time we reflash those Clear Story windows?
So the thought there on tier one was, while you've got a roofer here, put some more Band-Aid on that 6-inch sill.
Okay.
There's nothing to say you can't come back a year later and replace it. I think that's pretty small amount of money to do that reflashing of what's there. And if you look, you can see there is some leakage right
there. There's
some staining.
Oh yeah.
Right there. I'll bet you that corresponds with a joint and sheet metal.
And that's been like that for a long time.
Yeah.
Are you suggesting it would be wise while we're reflashing the sill, while we're actually glazing those Clear Story windows, to raise that sill?
Oh, I let me clarify. So in tier one, you're leaving the windows there.
Okay, mm-hmm. Without glazing them.
You're not doing anything.
Nothing.
You're just dealing with the leaks. The potential leak at the bottom of the window.
Okay.
You're just not touching the glass at all.
All right.
In tier two, you're taking it all out, you're raising the curb, you're putting new glass in.
Okay.
And he's recommending we do tier two.
So,
yeah. We're saying you can do this
one and two.
So one and two would be where we'd want to go.
One and two should be.
You should do all of
1.5.
About $40,000.
Yeah.
Definitely recommending the whole thing. Bob,
talking about tier number two, is that having like greenfield glass, removing it like you were talking about? And
even a little more extensive. They're actually going to replace the piece of glass and raise that.
In other words, we're going to chop it or put new ones in, or
yes.
Bring it up that 18 inches that you're talking about?
Build up that sill another foot. You put in new glass, it's
12
inches shorter than
okay.
What's there.
That's where a lot of the leaking.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else?
Bob? Question. We transferred out $15,000 from the expense tuition to collaboratives.
Mm-hmm.
And according to this financial statement, if it's accurate that we got tonight, that would still leave us with $34,882 that's not encumbered. And the account above it, expense tuition, not public schools, non-encumbered at this point, is $108,986.
Just because it's not encumbered doesn't mean we're not going to spend it. So we encumber the
what we know we have.
So some of our tuitions are encumbered, some of them are unencumbered. So I would have to again go back to our SPED director and ask her what her projection is to the end of the year of what we're going to actually spend. Because again, remember, I told you earlier this evening, we're having a little issue with the encumbrancing, and I'm just hoping it's affecting the payroll encumbrancing and not everything. It seems with our software, they fix one little thing, and when you think they're going to fix something that has nothing to do with something else. So before we couldn't change our client, because we have five clients, we couldn't change it because they made an upgrade. So now they fixed the clients. Did that screw up the encumbrancing? There's no rhyme or reason with these people.
You told me to see if I could find the money.
Yeah.
So anyway, anybody have any other questions for Mr. Hartman?
I think it was a great presentation.
I think it was wonderful.
Appreciate it.
I think you were well worth every penny.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, really. Even without the paint.
We haven't finished that yet. We'll get somebody to pay for it. We'll make it look pretty. We use Mad Dog.
It's an outstanding presentation.
Yeah, it was really, really good. Bob, are you gonna walk them out? Are you gonna stick around? I've got you for long range.
Do you need me to come back?
Do you want to go over long range facilities plan? We're supposed to.
I hadn't anticipated Lynn to be here tonight, so I really wasn't prepared.
Okay, we'll let you off the hook.
Hey, we can table. We've been tabling a lot lately, so we can table
it. All right, we've tabled it since November anyway. Yeah. The problem is we need to know what we want to do here first before we start talking about what's in our budget for the regular maintenance or up improvements to our regular maintenance.
So you've been tabled? And
April's a joint meeting, Cindy, so.
Till May. Yeah, till May. Get ready.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Bob. I appreciate it.
Okay, so we're going to revote the use of E&D funds for central off-book relocation.
Right.
We're going to revisit and then do the revote.
Do I have to do the revote on the E&D usage with the spreadsheet thingy?
That was where we got in trouble because we didn't do it right.
No, we got in trouble because we were out of a time window that we could have done it.
Yeah.
So we want to do it all. But you're saying if it's unanimous, it's no big issue. It's only if it's not unanimous that I got to go to the spreadsheet, right?
Oh, you're talking about the vote, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So moved.
Seconded.
Any discussion?
What are we talking
hearing
about?
None.
I have no idea. About. I just wanted to
voting the $28,000 for the.
Or sleep.
C, vote to approve $28,000 from the E&D account for central office move.
And vote.
I think we originally voted.
Yes, you had agreed to it, but it was.
But we didn't do it.
We skipped over the credit.
The money wasn't available.
I see what we have.
We had it certified at the time, so now it's.
Right, so now it's certified.
Yeah.
So hearing no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you.
Recorded as unanimous, sir.
The update from the building exploration committee. What did you explore?
Cindy, can we back up? Because we didn't vote the budget yet.
No,
and
we didn't.
And we're throwing Bob off on his notes because we're not following A, B, and C.
I was going to do that last.
Let's get the budget done.
You want some home?
He's freaking out over here.
you want the thing on the building exploration committee?
I really would rather take care of that little stuff and then do the budget last.
Okay.
So, no, you'll have to hold on.
We met Phil, myself, and Judy met yesterday, and Bob was detained with family business. Wasn't able to attend.
Dr. Carey.
Thank you.
I know, you kind of forgot about that.
Anyway, basically.
I called.
Report.
She didn't put my name down.
I was there.
So Bob.
But anyway, the sum of the whole thing is, we've talked to Waitley. They don't seem too interested in the building, and the consensus was we should go through the proper steps to advertise it for sale and let it take its natural course. Because if Waitley doesn't want it, I think it's better for them to own it. Then have it go to a third party first, but
they're not interested.
They don't seem to be interested. Mm-hmm. So,
can you legally do that when there's the oil tank in the ground?
We'll sell it as is.
I don't think that it's legal to sell as is with an oil tank in the ground.
Council will tell us.
I was going to say we need to just get that.
And we are.
But the thing is, we need to move forward. And I thought that they should take it and. Because they own the adjoining property, and it's in their best interest to own it, but they don't seem interested in it.
Okay.
So, but I think we're going to need, at the next meeting, I think the board should vote to abandon the building and do the formal procedures as to the Inspector General's requirements as to bidding and all the proper procedures and make sure that it's done and done properly.
So that'll be also in May.
Anybody else got anything else?
I have another question.
Go ahead.
So
the town of Waitley, even though they're not interested in taking the building back, that deed has easements, and those easements would have to go with the selling of the land.
Obviously, that's why it's in their best interest to own it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
All right, but they don't seem to be interested in it.
But I'm just going to warn you, I'm almost 99% sure that that oil tank's going to need to be remediated before we can sell it.
Okay, we'll check into that.
We're also checking into the records that are being stored right now at in the bowels of 219 Christian Lane, and we're going to be calling someone locally from Holyoke to come in, assess how much it would cost to digitize it. And Waitley has tendered a very soft offer, perhaps, for us to pursue taking what is totally essential and storing it in their Waitley Town offices in the corner for a fee.
All right, so that would solve that problem.
Yeah.
The paper problem.
The other thing you could also think about is set the town records back each of the towns, just keep frontiers mm-hmm. here.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so. All right, so I guess we should do the budget, but I need a number for a motion, so...
I have them ready for you.
Go ahead.
Madam Chair.
Because we have to do two votes.
Correct.
Right? Three votes? Just two?
No, two. We don't have any funds.
We don't have any debt.
All right, so two.
So the first motion would be to vote the fiscal 18 operating budget at $10,438,983.
So moved.
983.
Mm-hmm.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Opposed? One person is absent.
Two people.
Two people? Oh, Lynn. Yeah. Bill and Bill.
Lynn and Bill.
Lynn, Bill, and Bill. The Bill sitting next to me is not
yeah,
here.
Oh. But he's
he'll
not
be in back, the- but he didn't vote.
He's not in the room, but we still had him now. Just one of those were here.
Okay. Okay, so now we have transportation.
Yes, the second motion would be to approve a fiscal year 18 transportation budget of $277,962.
So moved.
So I have a second. Judy?
Yep.
Any further discussion on transportation? All those in favor? Opposed? Abstain? Unanimous of the people who are here. Okay, that didn't take half as long as I thought. Okay, so we are up to discussion of the Frontier Regional School District withdrawing from the NEAS, and it has Sarah Mitchell, Dr. Sarah Mitchell's name.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for having me, especially at this late hour after you've done so much work already. I'm going to ask Mr. Modesto to jump in as needed to support some of the statements that I'm making. And I'm here really representing the Frontier community as a whole, as in staff and administrators. So for those of you who aren't in secondary education, the New England Association for Schools and Colleges is an accreditation process that high schools and colleges typically undergo every 10 years. There's a self-study process that starts 2 years before the visit. Staff spend a lot of time examining practices, and then an accreditation, volunteer accreditation team comes in, examines what the school has done, and then makes a yay or nay vote on whether the school is accredited. There's also a 2-year report that the school provides to NEASC, usually in response to that annual, that 10 decennial visit, and then there's a 5-year report. So historically, this accreditation process has been very important for schools because schools didn't have a lot of ways to get feedback from an outside external organization and didn't have a lot of ways to study what was happening in the school and the environment. Recently, since Ed Reform 1993, there have been a lot more state and federal mandates placed on schools and a lot more requirements by particularly the state to give us information and feedback about how we're performing as a school district. We've been talking for a couple of years now about what really is the value of NEASC for our school at this particular time. There was a lot of conversation about 3 or 4 years ago from what we call the W schools out in
the eastern part of the state, Wellesley, Waltham, and a lot of those superintendents got together and said, it's not really being valuable, we need NESC to change the process. And while they have changed their process some, they really haven't changed it a lot. And what we're finding is some of the mandates or some of the requirements of NEASC are really counter to what the Department of Education is asking us to do. And so we're serving two masters a little bit. I recently, in October, in preparation for, we've been talking about this for a year at least now, and in October I went on a study visit to another school to see if the process had changed substantially since the last time we were accredited in 2010. It was similar. The team that I was serving with happened to be a good team, and I was clear about asking all of them what their experiences with NESC had been, and it was similar to what our last visit was like. They had all had at least one team in their background that they felt really wasn't very well prepared to be on that visit, and they didn't feel the information they were getting back from that team was worthwhile. That happened to be our 2010 experience. I'm not saying that all teams are like that, because certainly the team that I was on visiting with, I felt was a pretty high quality team, but it's a little hit or miss. So for that and all the other reasons that I stated so far, we are proposing to leave. So I wanted to give you, I gave you a two-page sheet that kind of outlines some of the best reasons to leave. One, in the past 2 years here at Frontier, we've had five external audits. Four of them were by the state. A couple of them were pretty comprehensive audits. 2016 DESE audit report really provided us with a comprehensive feedback and look and examination of ourselves. And then we asked an outside organization, PDK CMSI, to come in and do an extensive evaluation audit of our programs, particularly in special education. But I think those of you who saw the report, it was much more extensive than that. It really talked about the whole district and what we're doing, all the way from our policy, all the way down to what's happening in the classroom. So from those more comprehensive reports, we've gotten a lot of feedback that we've taken seriously and put into goals and district-wide goals as well as school goals. The second point is the sheer numbers cost of belonging to NEASC. So our dues have been $3,555 a year on any year that it's not an accreditation visit year. And then for the visit, it can be anywhere from $22,000 to $26,000, depending on how many people come in, where you put them up in hotels. And so you're looking at $55,000 over a 10-year period. We weren't really clear in our conversations what we were getting for those 9 years when the visit wasn't happening. I guess in theory there are conferences that you can go to at a slightly reduced fee. There are other membership organizations that we belong to that we feel like we get a lot more value for the money.
I have never accessed anything through NEASC in the 9 years I've been here. So I've never gone to a NEASC conference. Many of the programs they do have are either replicated out here or there's a better option somewhere else in the state. And I also want to talk about, when you talked about assessment a little bit, how we assess ourselves. NEASC was before MCAS. It was before any accountability. Basically the state you only had to send enrollment to the state. And now we send more data, that we have to have a data person, the amount of data that we send out. And I also want to, Sarah doesn't give any credit to herself. Sarah works with an auditing group that goes around nationally looking at major systems. So when you talk about someone who understands what an auditing process of a school looks like, she's brought in because she's a professional who understands how to audit. And when we have people who come here, as she said, we don't know what we're getting. And I know that because they ask our teachers to go on audits of other buildings. And many times I'm like, why would they pick that particular teacher? They're not experienced in auditing other schools or that kind of thing. And I see that quite often, that kind of thing. They asked me as a first year principal to go on an audit. That kind of thing. So I just wanted to, you're speaking from a level of expertise there. You didn't kind of say that. And not every person in your position has that level of expertise. So go on.
Thanks. So the last two pieces are the time involved. We have been very fortunate, because of your support, to have the early release Fridays where we've been able to do a lot of work on professional development and really improving our craft as teachers and working with students. Louise and Law and myself will be coming on April 6th and kind of showing you some of the results of that work that we've been doing. But the idea of spending a substantial amount of that time working through this self-study is a little disheartening, to have to give up those days and kind of put some of our initiatives on hold to spend time in this process. The last piece is the declining membership. So there are a couple of other schools right in our area that have withdrawn. Marhar is one of them. Ludlow is another one. And what we're seeing and hearing, and a lot of the state of Maine is actually out of NEASC. What we're seeing on the NEASC website, it's really hard to figure out exactly who's not a member anymore, because they tend to leave the school name up there. And I think they're, speaking of marketing, they're trying to fight a battle that's kind of slipping away from them. And so I think they're reluctant to take the names off the list. It may be something else. It may be just, secretarial, but I just don't understand why some of the names aren't on there, because we know from speaking to the school communities that they're not a part of the organization anymore. So there's a lot of pieces, a lot of thought. We did bring this to the whole faculty, and it wasn't surprising that they voted unanimously to withdraw from NESC if it was supported by the school committee, because of the amount of work that goes into it that doesn't seem lined up with the direction that we're going.
And I would say, please invite Allison to the conversation if you have questions about a teacher's perspective. I don't know what you'll say, but I imagine it's...
Bob, and Damian, and then Bill.
The question of what's the downside if we do withdraw?
We're not seeing the downside, and that's why we're making this proposal. Initially, we had this discussion probably 3 years ago when Wellesley and all those schools were talking about it, and our guidance department made calls to colleges because we were fearful that if we didn't have our accreditation, how were colleges going to view us? So guidance counselor Shelley Allen made a lot of phone calls, and there were some schools that did look at the accreditation, most of them did not, and we now realize that DESE provides so much information to a college that if they had a question about our legitimacy as an organization and a high-performing district, it would be easy for them to be able to go on the DESE website and verify who we are, what we do, with all the information that's out there. So we're not seeing a downside. That's why we're proposing this.
The one downside we did talk about is that we would have to work on areas of where we audit ourselves, where they come along every 10 years and they force you to look at certain things. We just went through, as the paperwork says, we went through a series of audits the last couple of years. But you also get complacent, go 10 years without doing any kind of self-study of looking at yourself. So I would say that's the one thing that we have to artificially put something in place where we do that. The state is already doing that for us because they're coming through with different audits every few years that are making that happen, but we have to make sure that we're staying on about looking at ourselves like we did with the SPED audit a few years ago, last year, and so on and so forth. So
Damian, next.
It's a similar question, but we were talking about marketing earlier. Is there an advantage to market our school being a member of this organization?
We're not seeing it. So I talked at great length with the Marhar superintendent, because I had all those questions too, because I did not want to put our school in a position where all of a sudden we're not on a level playing field with anyone else. They are not seeing any ill effects. So they have been out for 2-3 years now.
I think this is my third year
of the process. They're not seeing any changes in college admissions. They're not seeing any backlash from anything. They just kind of quietly went away from it. We're having the feeling that if Frontier withdraws from it, we may see other schools around us withdraw also. We've had questions already, because as I was talking to other superintendents about this, I said, keep us informed, because nobody's incredibly excited about this process anymore.
Bill?
So this is just an NEASC repeal. This is not an NEASC repeal and replace.
Correct.
We got to go to reconciliation.
So what you said about this, the discipline, the self-discipline that's required. So is there a sort of a plan to sort of institutionalize that self-discipline in some, with, I mean, I don't really know. I'd be the last person to tell you how to do that, trust me. But
I understand that. I was, you know, being bluntly honest in the sense of, you know, that's how I think you guys want me to be, that we have done more self-studies in the last few years with these last few audits than most schools have done. But my fear is that if you go 7 years without any one of those studies going on, then that's where an organization like that, you know, they come to you and remind you. I don't know what the states, you know, the states on the list of where the yearly cycle is,
right,
on those.
Some of these happen automatically, like the Title I compliance reports, the ELO compliance, all of those pieces happen automatically every 3 to 5 years. The CMSI audit that we brought in and the DESE audit is fairly random, and so I don't know when we would get one of that. That was a really comprehensive report, so I imagine that it's going to be another 6 or 7 before they would come back to us again. And CMSI, I would think in 6 or 7 years we would want to have an organization like that come back in and look and see what kind of progress we've made based on the recommendations that they made to us. So, yeah, but you're right, it would have to be self-imposed, and we would have to make sure we kept up with it, because you do need a third-party external look at yourself.
Bob,
and then Bill? Is the self-discipline set up some sort of in the self-evaluation system that you use and Darius uses to make it one of their goals to follow up on that sort of thing, and so it doesn't get forgotten?
Mm-hmm.
And I think if you track it there, you should be able to make sure it doesn't get
right,
forgotten.
Right, right, right. And I agree. I don't think with this particular team that you have in the district that it is going to get lost.
Oh, I don't think so either.
When I was talking, I wasn't talking about our team, but, you know, if we weren't, you know, things change over time, you know what I mean? And you know, 10 years from now, if you have a different administration here and you don't have, you know, you're not even here, do you don't remember being on the ask anymore? You know, I mean,
so, I mean,
Mary will still be here, but...
But if we get it to the evaluation, thing,
right,
it's
right.
going to get looked at
right.
yeah. twice a year.
Right.
You know, the yeah. goals for this year, right? And then, did you accomplish the goals? You know,
yep.
we're going to go on.
Yep.
I have no problem supporting the withdrawal.
Well, originally they'd asked for a vote, and I asked for a month to think about it, so we can take this back up in May. I don't know,
or April, even at the April when you do your little
at the joint if we do our the, little
yeah
kind of thing, we can do
habit.
That. I just wanted us to have a month, so if anybody wanted to Google it or talk to people, because some of us are in education, and see how people feel about that, and then we could get back to Sarah.
The only downside is that we do need you to make a decision soon, and like next month's fine, but. If we push it up to more, we have to change our professional development planning to accommodate the amount of work over the next 2 years. So our professional development is going to be dictated by this next year.
By June.
So I'm not saying, I'm just saying the consequence
April
of both, if you decide to stay in NEAS, we have to change our professional development plan. Probably 50%, if not more, of it will have to go
towards developing
plans. So you want this on the agenda for the April 6th meeting.
So it would be great to get it there, you know. I don't know how much discussion has to happen at that meeting in order to do the vote. So I don't know. I know you probably want to make a meeting short, but
it shouldn't be a lot of discussion. It's just that I wanted to give everybody an opportunity to check into it and not make. I mean, this is a lot of money, and NEASC has been around for a long time, and there are still a lot of schools still involved in them. And so I think we need time to just, if we want to, it's up to us to do some research on it and see. I totally take your word, as you know. I totally trust
you.
However, it is.
I would agree. That,
it is.
You know,
it's attached to a dollar. Amount, and I think we should check into
it. So,
Bill?
Was this the organization that offered the alternative for the superintendent search service?
No.
No.
That was totally different.
Okay.
This is 26, 23 people who descend on us every 10 years. And then I don't know
they
how many people come across.
Yeah. We wine and dine them.
Yeah. And as Sarah says, it depends on the group that you get, because some groups are not the nicest groups, and other people are really here to see if they can help you. So there's no consistency there. You don't know what you're going to get.
At the April meeting, Louise is going to be there, and you're going to be there also because you're making a presentation. So if anybody has any questions, they can ask them.
Right, right.
Oh, it's a district, though. It's,
no, it would be just
it
Frontier.
It would be just Frontier.
So, they, so yeah.
But she'll be there. So, she'll be there as the,
yeah.
As the...
Yeah, but they're going to make a presentation.
Yeah, yeah. She'll be there. They don't need to make a presentation at that while.
Not on that. They will
on
make
other
a
things. On other things. Okay. Anybody else have any questions? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have done all the votes we need to do. We have done all the discussion. So moving down the collaborative, Lynn is not here tonight, so we'll skip over that. Principal?
So I did put a report at your desk. I just wanted to move away just for 1 second. I know it's getting late, and I'm not going to kind of carry on with it, but I wanted to say something because I didn't comment during the public comment section. I was...
You're biting your tongue.
I was biting my tongue because I really was actually angry at some of the statements that were made, and I just want to make sure that you guys hear that if the direction of Frontier needs to change, that this group is vocal about. Because I heard tonight, we need marketing, and I understand what marketing is. I also understand about internal marketing, external marketing. It's very expensive. It's another part-time or full-time job. But if we feel that we need to do that to go get, then we probably should have discussions about it. Because I did have information. I have right here where our kids went to school last year. You know, we had kids getting into Brown, getting into, three went to Ithaca, I mean, I could go right down the list. You guys got the same printout of great schools. And I wasn't getting into an argument with people here, and I don't want to talk just about the top 10%. We're a public school. We educate every kid who goes through here. And I also don't want to talk about special education as it's an enemy. We do a great job of special education here. And that's why we have more special education kids in some way, because kids are going to this district and choosing us and tuitioning in because we do a good job. And so when we look at, we are, how I explain it to parents, we are UMass with the Honors College. We cannot be Hampshire College. You know what I mean? I just was taken back then when they said, let's be more like the charter schools.
No,
so do we want to be a dual language school? Okay, that's a whole different approach to education in Chinese. I don't even know where they get qualified dual language teachers in Western Mass. I mean, that's a challenge I don't know how they're accomplishing. Do we want to be a performing arts school? We have great arts in this building, and I think last week improved it that we can even step that up even further. We're trying to do that. We have a great music program, and we have a great arts program that puts portfolios together, drives students, individuals to college to portfolio day, and gets them to the best programs. And so I know you're probably saying, well, Dearest, why didn't you say this an hour ago? But I was too angry, didn't have my thoughts organized, and you guys have seen me when my thoughts aren't organized. And so it's like, how do you draw them back in? I don't know, and we're gonna probably go and have many conversations about this, but and looking at Lynn as well. But there's also, not everybody's gonna go to, not everybody thinks Harvard's a great school. You know what I mean? Not everybody thinks Yale's a great school. Not everybody thinks UMass is a decent school. You know what I mean? So I don't know, at what point do we change versus what point do we just, you give them all the, my strategy has been to all the information night is, and I say this bluntly to the parents, as they say, I just want to make sure you leave here with all the information to make your decision. If you don't want to come to Frontier, you have other choices. I mean, I can't even accept more students into next year's seventh grade class. It's too big. You know what I mean? So, talk about, we could try to advertise, but you can't come here. You know what I mean?
He's coming ninth grade.
Right. It's so great. I get it, but it's just kind of, I'm just saying as administrator with all the other stuff we have to do, marketing and admissions and all the other kind of thing, it becomes a level of frustration when I know, if we're not doing if our product isn't where it should be, that's our number one goal. Then if we have to market our product, I'd have to talk to marketing about really what is it? Are we going to get two or three of these names back? Is it going to pay for the marketing?
Right.
I don't know. I'm sitting here as a school, one of the school leaders, and I'm getting frustrated and confused because we're working as fast and as hard as we can and trying to do the same people we're talking about. You come to us with an increased budget every year, want me to make new programs look like other schools. And so it's like, yes, maybe with creativity and such, but it's like, I vented. Thank you.
We've got these public access cable channels that are available to us.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any possibility that we could use some of that time to our advantage by some of your audiovisual people putting some sort of a program together as to what's happening in the schools and people so can better understand.
We certainly can do that. In fact, most of the kids, most of the people that work at FCAT are either former students or current students. And so, I mean, that's not a, even that's not even hard to do. The question is, you know, how much of the public who are making choices about Frontier are watching public
action? I can tell you one thing. I run into more people that watch our meetings, and they watch everything.
And they're riveted tonight.
No, they are.
It's a good one tonight.
I will go a couple places in town, and I saw a woman the other day who was only 85, and she told me about her. I watch you all.
Oh, good.
So people are watching it. So it's what we're putting out, and if we could feed them some other stuff that's you know, that shows what we're doing in a positive section.
Phil and then Judy.
So a couple things. First of all, I loved how heartfelt that little spiel was right there, and I encourage you just to in that moment when you're afraid of being angry to just let them have it anyway. Because
don't ever give me that.
Seriously, this is the stuff in life that if you get angry at all over anything, this is the stuff. This is your kid. This is the stuff worth getting angry about, and it's okay to get angry about. And it's okay. This is important stuff. The other thing is that. I'll just give you an example. Last night in Conway, Jeremy Rogers came up and gave a talk. There were 79 people in the little thing. The fire marshal was all upset. And that is such stuff.
Say
like that.
Is that on TV again?
Andy got that?
He was there. He was there. Ben was there. But one of the great things about that is when you get a teacher up there to give a talk to the community, they get to see so many things that they. It was fantastic. You know, people walked out of there saying, "When's town meeting?"
And he does teach that class as an elective here at Frontier.
Yeah.
I want to make sure that gets on there.
Yeah.
Marketing.
And that's a great. Ask a teacher to come and give a talk to your town. And one of the things that he did say in his talk was that Frontier, on one or two occasions, right around budget time, did like a open house thing because. It is the truth that right now, around budget time, is when the community is most interested in what's going on here. And I don't have any recollection of this. He said it was 5 or 6 years ago. They did it once, but that supposedly it went over great. And I would just like to put that out there. That if it was that his recollection of it was that was the easiest budget time for all four towns. Like ever, so, and I don't know if you all have a memory of that, but that would be something that
I don't have a memory.
Maybe if we did it before and it worked, could we do it again?
Judy, do you have anything?
This is like the third meeting in 3 days that I've been told that we should market at. I get the idea behind it, but marketing for retention, marketing to build up. Spirit or information within the building, and then maybe out to the parent community, marketing to the townspeople. I mean, they're all different things. They mean all different things. They accomplish all different things, and they cost all different things. So, rather than, I think we heard the message. We hear it every year at budget time. I think at least the last three I've been paying attention. Four I've been paying attention. So maybe we talk about it for next year's planning and like really think about what is marketing. And it's not just the administration that's carrying the burden of it, but it's the school committee, maybe the subcommittee. I don't know the answer to it, but I don't want to talk about it.
So now you can finish your
report. So reading through our report real quickly, I just want to say it out loud since there's so many viewers at home. Guys and Dolls was a tremendous success. It has brought musicals back to Frontier. They're already talking about a new school next year, and it's really taking the arts in a whole new direction. And I want to thank Max Sherrill, Melissa Strelke, and David Peck, who were the leaders in that, and then all the parents and other staff members who donated their time. It was just wonderful. So if you didn't get to see it, you really missed out. So next year, you better put that in your calendar. As you know, MCAS is going on, or may not know, it's going on this week for 10th grade. They're still in paper test. We are going to be starting with the computerized test for the 4th and 6th. We did not do the shortened days that we did in the past because the window was not at the same time. Before, we could do middle school and high school at the same time, and it made sense to do a delayed start because so many staff members were involved with testing between the individual sites, the small group testing, the different needs for different students. This time it was not in the same window, so we had to do it during the school day the last few days. And then middle school will be done during the school days. However, we are looking at May. The math days in May is in the same window, so we may do a delayed start. The administration is just so much smoother when you can get kids, the distraction of other kids and moving and the teachers and all the staffing. To have to use teachers have not seen kids before, administering tests is not the best model. So I'll give them a report as we get closer to May. Just got off the bus, honest to God. She got her suitcases in her car for the juniors and seniors on the AP history. Give us two highlights, just because it's cool stuff.
Well, we had a meet and greet with Senator Warren yesterday afternoon.
Wow.
And we met with John Lewis for pictures.
Wow.
And we had an hour and 20 minutes with Jim McGovern on Monday afternoon. And we went to the African American History Museum as well.
And you're still awake.
I'm still awake.
So, but literally texted me at like 4:30. What time's the meeting? I'm still in the group. So there's dedication. Dutch exchange leaves next Thursday. The Spain trip leaves April 13th. And I just want to kind of know, as the DC trip also came back from for eighth grade, just the amount of work that these teachers go above and beyond to make those trips possible. And so just wanted to kind of say that. If you haven't given enough tonight, the blood drive is Friday. You're at Frontier if you want to give a pint of blood. All right, and the music telethon is next Thursday. It's a no miss, it's growing every year. They're already rehearsing. If you were here early enough, you would have heard them in the auditorium. So next Thursday, that is what I got. And then the backside has a bunch of dates and stuff. Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Superintendent. My report is going to be very brief, but I do want to point out that this year our audiovisual people developed a CD or DVD on school, and they went to the eighth grade classrooms. They started early. Our guidance department went and visited, the sixth grade classrooms to show the students what happens at Frontier, what's going on at Frontier, this is what we have, these are all the great things going on. And that kind of internal marketing is already been put in place, has already been put in place this year. And we hope next year we'll be able to even add more. We were told one of the greatest things, you know, that has happened was when, of course, there was the gas fumes in Conway, and all the students had to come down to Frontier, and the sixth grade students were like, this is a great place, and I love this place, I don't want to go back just to my building. So it is hard. We had this discussion at the Sunderland Town Hall and the Sunderland meeting last night, and you know, I'm going to try and figure out how to develop a brochure that tells everyone how wonderful the school is. For a different purpose, we don't need too many more students in Sunderland, but we also need to help people understand what the product is that we have in Sunderland. There's quite a raise in the budget. It's going to be a tough time. We cannot politically ask people to come to the meeting and vote for our budget, but we can certainly let people know that we have a wonderful school. I think most people will agree to that anyway. So marketing is a whole different world, and you can't cross over to the political side, so you have to be very careful. You can't tie it with budget, you can't tie it with our needs, or you can't criticize other education facilities or other educational organizations. But I do think that we could do a little bit more tooting our own horns. I know I do a superintendent's report every month, and I certainly could do that and even push out through
a power school system push out emails to families just so that they're aware of what we're doing. That's something that's available to all of us. I will really make an effort to do that, to certainly take some of that on as a superintendent. I'm very proud of our district. I've been in every single town meeting lately. I haven't really said much at the regional. There's just so much to talk about. But I have been in all the latest this past month, just really talking and reiterating how wonderful our schools are, our Union 38 schools, and what makes them wonderful. Each school has their own flavor. And when these children come together here at Frontier, it makes such a microcosm of society that makes Frontier the wonderful place it is. And not everyone is here, but these students have empathy, and they're conscientious, and they're good kids, and it's a safe school. There's so many things about Frontier that we could just go on and on about. So consequently, I do think that there's ways that I could do a little bit more outreach to the families. I certainly have the tool through Power School, and I certainly have the assistance of Sarah Mitchell, Louise Law, to help me, craft bulletins that could go out to the families. I do want to be careful that I don't be appearing to say vote for these school budgets, because that's a little bit too political for the superintendent, because that's the school committee's job. But I supported all these budgets. I've worked with all the principals to bring them forward. Patty has, Patty and I have had quite a few conversations. I'm, very conservative and trying to, understand the history, but I'm very proud of all the budgets we presented this year, and I know it's going to be hard. So
I liked everything that you said. That little bit, though, about you thinking that our urging people to come and vote for the budget was too political and that it's the school committee thing, the time for nice little polite distinctions like that is past. This is like massive, full-on, everybody roll up your sleeves and get into politics and get people to town meeting, or these things aren't going to pass.
I think I could tell them to come to town meeting. This is your town meeting. I really hope to see you there. Talk to me. I'll be there. But I don't want to cross that line. Yeah, I don't want to cross the line either. But we've met with all the town FinComs, the town committees, and we've been a little beat up, and it's been a long month. And so consequently, I will be pushing out some information, and I understand the need.
I think we can view the idea of marketing and communication along the same line. Greater levels of communication administratively in any way we can figure out is a form of marketing in itself.
Right. And I can use that tool to my advantage, and I will start doing that. As a new superintendent, I'm not that new anymore, but you also sit back and you watch, and you'll see me doing a lot more listening than talking. Probably, unfortunately, as I get more used to everybody, and those that know me better will know that I do tend to talk a lot. So, but I care deeply about the district and where we're going, and these budgets I'm very proud of, so I will try my hardest.
Thank you. Bob? Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Or wait a minute, any discussion?
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.